So there's a range of building infrastructures that might work for a producer, and it depends on if you want to be a hobbyist or if you want to be a really commercial producer. One of the main things to really consider is how much is that light valuable to you? Is it less or more expensive for you to produce heat or to produce light inside of a system? So there's some people that are growing inside of a greenhouse like we do because the light is more valuable to us, and we already had the greenhouse here. But other people are actually growing inside of warehouses, and they find that it's cheaper for them to produce light than it is for them to produce heat to keep everything warm, say during the winter months, which we have issues here in the temperate region doing that. So there's a lot of different styles of fish tanks. Some of them are round, some of them are square, some of them are cone bottom and deep, some of them are shallow. And it really all depends on the fish species you want to grow. And making sure you have something that's food safe. You know, the tanks that we have here are made out of high density polyethylene, or HDPE. Some other fish tanks you might have fiberglass, or some people even have stainless steel, although that's a very expensive option. But you could go as far down as having a rubber lined container to grow these fish in, or a stock tank or something like that. But it's whatever you're able to get the solid waste out of the tank efficiently and the fish do well in, and that's going to be based on the species you're growing. So there's different ways to remove solids, but more or less you're going to use either a mechanical filtration process of a screen of some sort, or you might use a settling process where that water is able to slow down and fall by gravity out of solution. Biological filtration is the process, bacteria-mediated process, of transferring ammonia, which is NH3, into nitrite, which is NO2, and then into nitrate, which is NO3. So in that process, you're adding oxygen into that system. That's the reason why aeration is extremely important. You want to have high amounts of aeration in that water, and just providing a good pH and environment for those bacteria to live in. So a hobbyist is probably going to look for basically the cheapest thing that they can get in order for them to move the amount of water that they need. And in a system like this, you're going to want to move your water through the fish tank about 1 to 3 times per hour. So based on the volume of the tank, you know, you're going to want to size your pump based on that, and the head, or the difference between elevation of where the pump's at and where the water's going to. For these tanks, we have 30-gallon tanks, so we want to have at least 100 gallons per hour of flow going through the systems in order for us to completely filter the water the number of times we would like for it to. You know, in a system like this, you're really looking for efficiency of energy usage. So there's different types of pumps that you might use. The two main schools is going to be like a centrifugal pump that's going to push water through mechanical methods, or you're going to use something like an airlift pump that utilizes the buoyancy of bubbles to pick up the water and then move it. We use submersible pumps in these systems because it keeps you from having to drill holes in the tanks, and it makes it a little bit easier in regards to that, but maybe they don't last as long and they may not be as energy efficient in a system like this. So it really depends on what scale you're going to work on and what you have access to. An impeller pump is basically a magnetic drive pump. It's going to have an axle with several propellers on it. And so as that magnet starts to ramp up, it'll spin those propellers, and that's going to force water through a tube and then into the culture system. Backups to your backups is going to be really important to have in a system like this for pumps, electricity, things like that, because whenever one of these items fails, you're going to have something to replace it very quickly, or else you might lose your fish. So right now we're going to check dissolved oxygen in the system using this probe. We'll do this on a daily basis, and that's just to make sure that there's enough oxygen for the fish and all the bacteria. So we're going to go ahead and drop this probe in the water. Then